one volume, one dynamic,
all right, all the way through.
But no, it's like when you can come down on that tune, great.
Great. Cool.
Did you say like an opening or something with the pipo?
I detuned the whole thing one whole step, so like normal. So I have to use this pipo here to play normally.
Switch in
the same. The Patriot.
Yes.
I'm going to need
Sunday, everybody.
Everyone, and a blessed Palm Sunday as we begin our Holy Week together. We're glad that all of you have joined us, both in person and online, and we are filled with joy and gratitude this day as we can come together in worship. Let's begin this time now by greeting our friends and loved ones who've gathered around us today. Welcome once again, everyone. It's a wonderful and full time in the life of the church, so I want to share with you a number of opportunities for you to engage in the different programs and ministries that we offer. Of course, with today as being Palm Sunday, we are entering into Holy Week, and we have a full menu of services for you to participate in and attend, and we invite you to do so. On Thursday, we will remember the Last Supper that Jesus shared with his disciples and his commandment that they love one another and to serve as he exemplified by washing their feet. So we will come and commemorate that together. We'll be sharing the sacrament of Holy Communion, and that'll be at 7 p.m. on Thursday evening right here in the sanctuary. Good Friday, the very next day, once again at 7 p.m., we remember the suffering death of Jesus and being placed in the tomb. That is a reading of the Passion story from his time in the Garden of Gethsemane until being laid to rest. We will have music as part of that with the chancel choir, and we invite you to take part in that solemn service as well as we prepare ourselves for the joy of Easter, which happens, of course, next Sunday, 8:30 and 10:30. 8:30 will be our traditional service with the choir and brass quintet. And then, of course, you can join us at 10:30 for witness and guest as well as we celebrate resurrection and new life. So please come and join us for any and all of these services. What would Easter be without an Easter egg hunt? And we have a wonderful front lawn in which to do that. So Eric Grimm-Schmidt and Family Ministries will be sponsoring this after each service. So there'll be one at 9:30 and 11:30. And it's not just going to get eggs with candy, but to get as many eggs as possible to exchange for prizes, Chuck E. Cheese style. So we hope some of you get that, yeah. We hope that you will join us and bring your children, your grandchildren, so they can all enjoy that activity following each service next Sunday. Okay, Reconnect. This is a new small group that we have kicked off. It is a outgrowth of Moms Connect, but here we are focusing on parents with children and youth from 13 to 30, a little bit broader than empty nesters. But it's basically a time for us as parents to come together and reconnect with each other in our own spiritual journey as we now have young adult children. We're going to be meeting on the first Sundays of each month, so the next one is scheduled for April 7th, 11:30, following the service for lunch and a program. And we hope if you are in this category and you'd like to reconnect that you come and do so with us. Okay. Missions Committee and the United Women in Faith will be hosting their annual rummage sale. This is a big event and big tradition for our congregation. Typically, $10,000 or more is raised. All of those proceeds go to fund ministries within our church and outside the walls of this congregation in the local community. But it needs everyone's help to make this possible. So if you have items to donate, we'd love to have those starting the week of April 14th. And if you can volunteer some time, both in help setting up the items in Marketplace, doing checkout, etc., there's a need for that as well. So if you're interested in helping out, there's a sign-up table out front, and they'll gladly take your name and give you more info for what's coming up. And also, we want to make sure, once again, that you're aware that there will be a women's retreat hosted at La Mesa First United Methodist Church. It's happening on April the 20th, and it's revolving around spiritual practices. I understand there'll be different spiritual practices for those who are attending to participate in a workshop kind of basis. April 15th is the registration deadline, and you'll find the link for registration in our weekly newsletter. And last but not least, we, at the first service, had our wonderful bell ringers, the harmony ringers, and you also hear them occasionally once a month as we go through worship. They are hosting our coffee cart today, and it's kind of chilly outside. Today is a perfect day to grab a cup of coffee as you join in fellowship together. And if you have any questions about harmony ringers or would like to try it yourself, please stop by and ask those questions. We give thanks to God for all of these blessings. If you are going to Kids Connect, Eric and the leaders will meet you out in the narthex at this time. If you're staying with your family, do so at this time too, as we ask witness to lead us in our next song.
Some days I climb the mountain, some days I touch the clouds, some days my best friend has been the cold hard ground. There's mercy new each morning. Come high. My eyes are fixed on Jesus, and I'm going to be all right. I've got that hallelujah feeling down in my soul. I've got that hallelujah feeling that I won't let go. I've been born again, yes and amen. No matter what comes, I know I've got that hallelujah feeling down in my soul. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, just because it's raining doesn't mean the sun won't shine. There's a season for the struggle and a season for the price. But my hope is never fading, 'cause it's anchored in the truth. My Father goes before me and he's gonna see me through. 'Cause I've got that hallelujah feeling down in my soul. When everything is shaking, got that solid rock like pavement. I'm a pin, but I'm not breaking. The Lord is on my side. And I've got that hallelujah feeling down in my soul. I've got that hallelujah feeling that I won't let go.
Thank you, witness. We come now to the time in our worship to lift up our prayers to God, and we do so in two different ways. We have our own personal and private prayers that we lift up. As a reminder, if you're with us in person, we have two tables at the front with candles. You're invited at any time during the prayer time to come forward to light a candle and to lift that prayer to God in silence. But we also gather our hearts together with prayer requests that come to us from our Foothills family of faith. And I ask that you keep these in mind as we lift up our prayers today. Prayers for Bonnie Chambers. Bonnie has been going through a number of health issues and unfortunately was readmitted back into the hospital for some internal bleeding this past week. She's home now, but our prayers are for an accurate diagnosis and treatment. Also, as you have received by email this week, we grieve the loss of one of our longtime members, Willie Randall, at the age of 94. He was such a gentleman, and I'm grateful to be able to have a visit with him and his family before his passing, which was peacefully at his home. So prayers are with the Randall family at this time as well. With these and all others upon our hearts now, let us enter into a time of prayer. Witness will lead us into a time of centering, followed by a time of silence, then our pastoral prayer and singing our Lord's Prayer.
Cheese.
O God, today we stand at the gates and shout Hosanna, waving our palm branches high as we greet Jesus, our King. Let joy fill our hearts this day as we welcome him into our lives. And remind us, O God, that our souls need to welcome him in both celebration and in commitment to his witness. God, we take time this morning to lift up to you our own prayers and prayers for our loved ones and neighbors in need. For families and friends who grieve the loss of loved ones, especially for Willie Randall and his family this day, we pray that you will embrace them in your love and care and comfort. For those who are struggling with disease and illness, facing surgery or recovery, be with each and every one of them. Grant them your healing grace in this time of need. For neighbors who are weighed down by life's daily challenges, who are struggling to just even meet the basic necessities of life, of food and clothing and shelter, be with them and empower us as followers of Christ to share of ourselves, our gifts, and our service to help our neighbors in need. And for all of those who are isolated and alone, far from the company of loved ones, be with them in this time and help us to remember them and to reach out with love and care and to remind them that indeed they are part of the body of Christ and our brothers and sisters in faith. Hear our prayers for all who need your healing love. Lord, you entered Jerusalem with peace in your heart, and we confess that our world is engulfed in violence and warfare. From Israel and Gaza to Ukraine and Russia to Haiti. Be our vision, O Lord, that we too can live as people of peace in the face of the world's many conflicts. May we hold your vision of justice and peace ever before us, especially in this week ahead. And as we enter this holy week, O Lord, keep us centered in worship and prayer and service. Bless us as we enter into the days, needing your power and presence to sustain us as we move through them together. From the final meal that you shared with your disciples, through your suffering and death upon the cross, to the empty tomb, and to new life and resurrection on the third day. Spirit of love and life, stay close as we walk with you. We lift up these prayers to you, O God, in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, singing together.
Forever and ever, amen. Good morning. Today's scripture is from Mark 11, verses 1 through 11. Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this: 'The Lord needs it,' and will send it back immediately." They went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing untying the colt?" They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Let us pray. O Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of those gathered together be acceptable unto you, O Lord, our rock and redeemer. Amen. Last May, the world watched as Charles III became the new king of the United Kingdom. And while the monarchy for Great Britain is now largely ceremonial, people still line the streets of London for miles to watch the royal procession, hoping to catch a glimpse of the new king and queen. And if you watched it on television, you saw it yourself. All the hallmarks of power were there. The elaborate uniforms, the troops on horseback, the fur-lined robes, and the crown jewels resting upon the king and queen's heads. It's how history has always viewed and celebrated the rise of a new monarch surrounded by glory and power and wealth. Today, as we enter Holy Week, we heard in the Gospel of Mark, as Suzanne shared with us, about another royal procession, this one in Jerusalem 2,000 years ago. And on that day, people lined the road that led near and into the Golden Gate of the Old City. And they were waving palm branches like we were earlier this morning and shouting, "Hosanna!" proclaiming that a new king had been crowned. But you'll notice in this story that there are no uniforms or troops or crown jewels, because this royal procession was different from one that had ever happened before and probably ever since. And it begins for us the story of Jesus' last days of ministry. Now, you've heard over the past few weeks how this journey took place, how Jesus and his disciples started in their home country region of Galilee, and how they healed the sick and fed the hungry and spread the good news. And then they made their way to Jerusalem together, to the capital city. And along the way, they continued their work, and Jesus taught through parables and debated with the Pharisees and scribes about the interpretation of the Hebrew scriptures, and even predicted his own suffering and death. When they finally neared the city, they were in the neighboring village of Bethany, and Jesus instructed his disciples to go and find a colt that he could ride. And he knew that was important symbolically because the prophet Zechariah, centuries earlier, had written about it and said, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter Zion. Shout aloud. Lo, your king comes to you. Triumphant and victorious is he. Humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." So this is the day when Jesus would fulfill that prophecy. The disciples did as he instructed, and Jesus climbed atop his humble steed, and he made his way down the Mount of Olives and into the valley and then up the hill to the Golden Gate. And you can trust that his followers did not miss the meaning of these actions. As you heard in the story, they took off their cloaks and laid them on the road before him. And they took their branches and sang their praises loudly and shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David." They weren't hiding it. It was very clear. It was clear to anyone who had knowledge of the Hebrew scriptures that the Messiah, a new king, had arrived, representing the kingdom of God. And he had come to lay claim to his throne. He didn't come with weapons or an army, but he did come with a challenge, nonetheless, to both the religious authorities who controlled worship at that time and political authorities who ruled on behalf of Rome. Of course, you may recognize that there's a problem with that. There's a problem with Jesus being proclaimed king by the crowds because it turns out there was already a king in charge of Jerusalem. His name was Caesar, and he ruled the entire Mediterranean world. And he had appointed a governor by the name of Pontius Pilate to rule on his behalf in Jerusalem. And while the Pharisees and scribes debated matters of theology and scripture, the Romans were concerned about two things, really: people paying their taxes and keeping order in the empire. So you can see when someone starts claiming that they are king and they have a following, Rome is going to be nervous and they're going to crack down. And they did, in short order. You ever have a conversation with someone and something they say changes the way you look at the world and you carry it with you from that point forward? That happened to me. It was about a little over 20 years ago, and I had the opportunity to meet and have dinner with a New Testament scholar. His name is John Dominic Crossan. And Crossan was a leader of a group of New Testament scholars that focused on what we would call the historical Jesus. In other words, their focus was not on him and being the divine Son of God or being the apocalyptic Messiah that would welcome in the new kingdom. Instead, they focused on Jesus and the scriptures of what he meant in his time to the people then and there, and trying to get meaning out of that. And as we were discussing, I remember Crossan saying this. He says, "You know, the Gospels are all about kings and kingdoms and who is in charge. Who is in charge? Is it Caesar and the powerful Roman Empire? Or is it this Jewish peasant from Galilee and his ragtag bunch of followers? And after I heard that, every time I go back to the Bible now and I read about Jesus and his titles, and I hear things like Son of God or Son of David or Lord or King, I think about it in a totally new way. Because every time those titles are used to describe Jesus and his movement, we have to remember that it was a challenge. It was a challenge to those who ruled by might and oppression. And they were saying that the reign of Caesar on this earth was being replaced by the reign of God. That the poor and oppressed would be lifted up through mercy and compassion and peace. So as we gather today on this Palm Sunday, we have to remember that what we are remembering is a protest. It's a protest against the current powers that rule, both the religious powers and the political ones. Jesus' entire ministry to this point was a challenge to the status quo. He criticized the chief priests and the elders and scribes when he felt that their interpretation of the Hebrew scriptures were too narrow or legalistic, that compassion for others should be the priority, and that when religion ignores that priority, then something has to change. Remember, he was criticized for healing on the Sabbath or feeding the hungry on the Sabbath. And he reminded them that human beings were more important than that legalistic following. And the same is true on the political front. Jesus was opposed to those rulers of the Mediterranean world, the Roman Empire. The empire controlled every territory, every group, through its economics and its power and military. And those at the bottom of the hierarchy, at the bottom of the ladder, they had no power whatsoever. And they were reminded of that all the time through the great architecture that they erected to the very coins that they used that had the head of Caesar on it and it said Son of God. In opposition to that movement, something arose. Starting with John the Baptist at the Jordan when he baptized Jesus, to then Jesus leading his movement. And their message was always different than the status quo. That the poor would be lifted up, that the blind and lame would be healed, and prisoners set free. That Jesus, not Caesar, was the true Son of God, even as he humbly sat upon the back of a colt. For the new king had come to assume his throne in Jerusalem. And we can feel it this morning in our worship with the songs and the prayers and the scripture, that when Jesus enters those gates, there is a moment of hope and joy in our hearts that the kingdom of God does seem to be at hand. That we are witnessing this royal procession, waving our palm branches to commemorate the event. But then we're reminded that it's only for a moment. It's only for a moment for what is about to follow in the days to come. Soon Jesus will be betrayed by one of his best friends. Soon he will be arrested and brought before Pontius Pilate to be interrogated, to be asked, "Are you really the king of the Jews?" And when he's going through that, everyone else is going to leave. He's going to be all alone, deserting him. And he's going to be sentenced, and he's going to be mocked, and he's going to have a crown of thorns rather than crown jewels placed upon his head, led to a cross. And he will die a public death for the sole purpose of the empire to say, this is a warning. There's only one king, and his name's Caesar. And ironically, Jesus will die on a cross with an inscription above his head that says, Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews. I love that line in Shakespeare's play from Henry IV. Uneasy lies the head that wears a crown. And Henry IV says that in the play when he's up late at night, early in the morning, everybody else is asleep, and he's weighed down by the responsibilities of his office and power. And on the one hand, we might say that Jesus' head was weighed down by a crown of thorns and his suffering and death. But maybe we should consider that it was Pontius Pilate's head that was weighed down, bowed as he washed his hands, trying to remove the stain of guilt for handing Jesus over to be crucified. Maybe he realized in that moment his grave error. Maybe they realized it that when they got the news on the third day that some women had arrived at the tomb and found it empty. Maybe they realized it when they started to get news reports of Jesus being resurrected and eyewitnesses encountering him. Maybe they realized it when that news began to spread and people began to have hope and it got out of control from the empire. That the movement that Jesus and his followers that had begun had not been stopped, but instead had continued to grow even faster. On this Palm Sunday, my friends, remember this. The kingdom of God is indeed at hand. And the kingdom of Rome, its end was already on the horizon. We'll discover that on Easter. Amen. Friends, we give thanks to God for our many blessings here at Foothills as part of our denomination, as part of the body of Christ and the universal church. And we give thanks by sharing in worship and prayer and praise, by giving of ourselves in service and giving of our gifts. If you wish to make a gift today in person, there's a basket in the narthex where you may deposit it. Or today or at any time, you may give online on the way shown before you on the screen. Let us keep that in our hearts and minds as we give thanks to God. And as witness leads us now in our offertory, I've witnessed it.
I've witnessed
Witness. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we give thanks this day, this Palm Sunday, when we welcome your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, into our lives once again. But we know, O God, that the week ahead will have many ups and downs, filled with both sorrow and joy. Guide us in this time. Help us to walk faithfully through the Last Supper, through the suffering and death of your Son, and yes, to celebrate new life and resurrection on Easter Day. We place our trust in you, and help us, O God, as we move forward into this Holy Week, that we may be servants, disciples, ones who show your love to all in a hurting world. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. I invite you to raise your palms and wave them as we sing our last song, We Walk by Faith.
I'm
Jesus, our Christ, our Lord, once again, and go and share with this world the good news. Love is coming. Resurrection and new life awaits us all. Go in peace in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Every step I take is a step of faith. To live by faith, and we put our trust in